Welcome to India Hangout. The question that we are asking today, are coal-based power plants a larger environmental threat? To discuss that, I'm joined by Nagaraj Adve, member of the India Climate Justice, Manu Sharma of Climate Revolution Initiative. Both are essentially campaigners on the issue of pollution and climate and the larger theme of climate. So let's understand first from Nagaraj. What's your sense? You know, I was reading this article by Jairam Ramesh, former environment minister, which seems to paint a pretty alarming picture. It talks about, among other things, the fact that emissions from power plants account for more than half of greenhouse emissions in India, and which is carbon dioxide. Moreover, there's a direct correlation, possible direct correlation between coal-based power plants and infant mortality, which means, according to him, infant mortality is not improving, or there is less improvement in areas where there is coal-based power plants. So there are two or three correlations which I just want to understand a little better. Why don't you go first?
Well, yeah, I think Jairam Ramesh is making a very strong and an important point at different levels. At one level, I think his argument emphasizes the fact that local people tend to be very heavily affected by various kinds of particulate and other kinds of pollution emanating from these plants. That's one. And secondly, also we need to not forget the fact that workers who work inside these coal plants, coal mining, and other kinds of entities are also very heavily affected. And it is true. I mean, we're talking about two different scales and kinds of pollution and effects. So talking of one, that scale that's over a fairly wide area locally and beyond regionally. And in terms of climate change, we're talking about something that is effectively global in a sense. And so even though coal effects can be very extend for hundreds of kilometers, we're talking of two different scales and also two different in terms of time scales, because as we know, effects can be felt for thousands of years. Yeah? But in terms of the effects on children and health effects, there are extremely serious effects of sulfur dioxide. For instance, there's a study by the School of Public Health at the University of Illinois at Chicago, which talks about inflammation, hyper-responsiveness, aggravates bronchitis, decreases lung function. That's right. All due to asthma, emergency, all due to sulfur dioxide. It says that, importantly, even low concentrations, I'm now quoting here, even low concentrations of sulfur dioxide associated with increased risk of death from heart and lung conditions. For every 10 parts per billion increase in SO2 concentration, there is a 0.4% to 2% increased risk of death. So we're talking about very clearly, you know, extremely serious. And India has, you know, clearly more standards as far as sulfur dioxide, and that sense too is correct. Which is, for instance, all, to the best of my understanding, all that the MOEF mandates is that power plants of a specific capacity have, you know, stacks of a particular height so that these matters can be kind of dispersed.
Yeah. Right.
So for say, for a 500 megawatt kind of plant, you might have a stack of 275 meters and so on. So all it means is they're essentially dispersing the pollution even wider.
Right.
As I told you, even low levels of...
Let me come back to you in a second. Let me get a sense from Manu as well. Manu, I mean, just to kind of give someone who's watching this a broader idea of what is the environmental threat we're looking at. Now, first of all, let's acknowledge that, I mean, this has been there all this while. It's not like all these coal-based power plants came up suddenly. And obviously, most countries in the world are either grappling with or looking at similar scale of power generation, at least the developed world. So in that context, how bad is it today, and has it become worse in recent years?
All right. So the first thing is to understand that sulfur dioxide is not a new problem. I mean, Jairam Ramesh portrays it in such a way that it appears that it's a, you know, it's a new concern. Since 1970s, we have known that sulfur dioxide has health impacts in the regional area where its emissions are released. Okay, so and it's a.
Manu, are you saying between sulfur dioxide and carbon dioxide, I mean, which is more dangerous? I mean, carbon dioxide, for instance, as emissions from power plants account for more than half of greenhouse emissions in India. I mean, so one is carbon dioxide in general, and the fact that most of it comes from power plants.
Govind, there is no comparison at all. Okay. We are considering both of these as pollutants. They're not pollutants. So one, sulfur dioxide is a traditional pollutant.
Right.
Now you need to understand the difference between pollution and carbon dioxide emissions. They're completely different areas. It's like apples comparing apples and oranges.
Sure,
okay?
Sure.
So carbon dioxide exists in the
In the
atmosphere.
environment,
Once it
yeah.
is released, CO2 exists in the atmosphere for thousands of years. And one molecule of CO2 has a factor of 100,000 in terms of the amount of heat that is let into the atmosphere because of greenhouse gas emissions, which is trapped in the atmosphere by release of carbon dioxide.
Right, I
Okay.
get that. So let's keep carbon dioxide aside for now and let's
Right.
focus on sulfur
Yeah,
and yeah.
just let me complete. Just let me complete. So sulfur dioxide, on the other hand, is released in the atmosphere and it has health impacts in the region, whereas CO2 gets distributed globally. So one is a global concern whose impacts we will see for decades and centuries in the future. On the other hand, sulfur dioxide has, I'm not saying it's not serious at all. It has serious health hazards. It has, it can lead to lung cancer, it can lead to, sorry, lung diseases and other health hazards.
Right.
And acid rain is caused by sulfur dioxide. So sulfur dioxide is serious, but carbon dioxide emissions are in completely different league
Got it. No,
altogether.
I got
You
that. Yeah.
cannot compare them with traditional pollutants.
Got that, Manu. Nagraj, let me come back to you. Let's focus on sulfur dioxide. I mean, one of the points that Jairam Ramesh makes in his article, sulfur dioxide emissions up 71% between 2005 and 12 in the states, and highest proportionate increase in the states of Chhattisgarh, Gujarat, and Odisha. Now, what are the linkages here? Is it because more power plants have come up that we are seeing more sulfur dioxide emissions? Number one. Number two, should there be have been a monitoring, I mean, a monitoring capability for this emissions which did not exist?
Are you asking that question of me?
Yeah, that's right, Nagraj.
Yeah, no, so very clearly, that suggests two or three things. Because one, it's definitely the rise that he talks about now, about 71% since 2005. The data we have for 2005, that's about 1,900 kilotons of sulfur dioxide in 2005. Yeah, and now that's gone up by 71%. And clearly, that's happening because of the expansion of coal power mining as well as coal power generation in that area, no doubt. And mind you, over the considerable protest of locals and movements and so on. So that is one. Secondly, the fact is clearly there's a greater regional concentration then, which probably dissipates as it goes wider, but it still also is felt wider. So there are at different levels, very clearly its effects being felt and studied at different places. I'll give you an example, for instance. They have these plans to have a, take one ultra mega power plant, say in a place called, let's say, Chayur in coastal Tamil Nadu. Studies show, for instance, is going to generate 576 tons of SO2 every single day. That's not counting your 260 tons of nitrous oxide and 100,000 tons of CO2 every single day from one single ultra mega power project. But clearly, the rise in data for these three states suggests that it's happening because of an expansion of coal-based power. That's one. Two, technologies exist. I mean, there are existing technologies which can be put in place for sulfur dioxide concentration, at least minimize its effects. For instance, there are seven power plants that have this thing called FGD, flue
Right.
gas desulfurization plants. These are existing technologies. You need to put them in place before setting up these plants and so on, very clearly. And three, as Manu said, it's a very different scale that we're talking about. So what it clearly does, it in a sense, it questions our energy choices. So should we then move away very quickly towards a more renewable strategy? And two, I think it very fundamentally questions our development trajectory in general. As in, who are we generating this power for? Where is it going? Who uses it? Very clearly, even in local areas where coal is being mined and coal is being, where power is being generated, local people don't have electricity. So where is the bigly going? So it raises a whole range of wider questions.
Right.
But like Manu
Nagraj,
says, these are
yeah,
tougher.
Nagraj, how, if we were to now compare this, let's say, sulfur dioxide emissions in specific to other countries like China and the United States, where do we stand proportionately?
Well, I'm told that, I have some data which at the moment I don't seem to be able to find. But clearly, obviously Chinese emissions are significantly higher. Let me just look for it if I can quickly. No, sorry, I don't seem to find it. Yeah, so I'm told that for one, like I said, we don't have any standards at all, unlike some of the other countries. But there's no doubt that in China, particulate matter, smog, ozone, local pollution is an extremely huge issue in a sense. In some ways, it's a much larger issue in China. than it is in India at the moment, because there is a much greater public sort of sense of disquiet about the fact that it's impacting health, cancers, etc. There's no doubt. So in a sense, I feel that these kind of issues are, you know, more prevalent in people's consciousness in China than say something like climate change.
Right. Okay. Manu, can I come back to you now? So if we were to take the whole sulfur dioxide argument further, what should we be talking about? You know, for instance, Jairam Ramesh talks about the need for concentration standards for sulfur dioxide. So that's one way of addressing the issue and say, okay, let's effectively monitor and then manage. What else?
Well, you'll have to bring in another dimension to the whole debate of capacity addition, and you'll have to look at why are we doing capacity addition when we know we have exceeded the budget we have for CO2 emissions, okay? So the usual argument that's given out by the government is because we have to, we are a poor country, we have to raise the status level of the poor, that, you know, we have to develop, we have to grow. But, you know, if you look at the physical limits of the planet, and if you look at, you know, these are driven by laws of chemistry and physics. So, I mean, I completely understand that India wants to grow, but laws are not, you know, mutable to your desires. The laws of science and physics clearly say that we don't have scope for putting more CO2 out in the atmosphere, regardless of, you know, national boundaries or regardless of where it is emitted. So we have to really rethink and re-question the whole idea of continuous economic growth in a finite ecosystem where your resources are finite and where you do not have any budget for continued emissions. So, I mean, that dimension has to come into the picture, and that,
got it. Okay.
You know, fundamental assumption has to be questioned.
Okay. So Nagraj, are you in agreement with that? I guess so. But, you know, I mean, one part of the argument is to say that we need to look at some fundamental solutions. I mean, the larger solution obviously is to cut back demand in some way, which is therefore the way we live and the way we consume. The second is to say that can we address these problems with better technology and more appropriate use of technology? Between the two, where are you leaning and what are your thoughts?
Well, I clearly lean towards the former in terms of we need a political solution. Having said that, I actually believe we need to work at different levels simultaneously, which is to say that we need to have appropriate technologies, because one can't dismiss them. You know, greater energy efficiency, they have a whole range of co-benefits and sort of side benefits and so on. We also need to implement this defluorination I talked about earlier, you know, the FGD and so on, and applying FGD in these plants. So there are clearly technological technological steps forward that need to take on with urgency. That's one. Having said that, also is questions of a larger politics, as in where is the demand coming from? How do we cut down elite emissions? How do we cut down elite use? I mean, is it fair that, for instance, Ambani's power bill is believed to be something like 72 lakh rupees a month, when millions of people in this country, you know, 400 million people don't have access to electricity? You know,
yeah.
Is it fair that people have three cars, three ACs in their houses, and so on? I mean, can't there be, say, a limit on incomes? This is not so far out. I mean, India used to have a luxury income tax earlier, you know, so we need to have, I'm just saying that that's why I raised the question for development trajectory, you know, which way are we going and why? Because the effects of coal power generation is very clear at different levels, whether it's sulfur dioxide or whether it's carbon dioxide. You know, these are now known, clearly known facts, and then very widely known and widely felt. And let me just add two things. One is that it's felt not just by human beings, but also by millions of species. Yeah, I mean, I have a note coming out which talks about in the EPW soon, which talks about the range shifts in range of several species across different ecosystems in India due to global warming and climate change. All right, so that's one. And secondly, I think we need to then think of what would be an urgent energy transition. You want to move away from coal, how do we move it, make it a smoother transition for workers employed there, for poorer people who need to be provided with electricity? What kind of transitions are possible? And unions in this country and other organizations like NTUI, NTMSO are engaging in these questions. I think the key question I think is urgency. Because somewhere even this debate that's going on about climate change, about 2 degrees and so on, fact is one, 2 degrees is already way too high, which is why countries and a whole range of people's organizations are saying that 1.5 degrees is a much safer level, that's one. And two, that we are committed to warming. There's a committed warming in the pipeline that already takes us certainly close and possibly even beyond 2 degrees. But urgency is somewhere missing a lot of debates that are going on.
Right.
And that needs to
okay.
be brought forward again.
Yeah.
And just one last thing, which was that there was a People's March in Delhi, which happened 2 days ago, where there were a range of students from different colleges, but there also were organizations from coal-fired plants, from coal mining areas, sort of opposing them because they clearly said there's a loss of life, of livelihoods, access to forests, forest produced, medicinal plants, agriculture, and so on. Which took place just 2 days ago. There's a link to the protest that took place in New York yesterday, organized by 3PT.org.
Right. Thanks. Thanks for that. So, Manu, tell me about the work that you are doing in this area. I know you're doing a lot of work across climate change, but in the particular area of fossil-based fuels and the fact that a country like India is going to obviously consume a lot of it, what's the kind of work and what's the direction that you're going?
Well, the method that I've used is to use RDI as a tool
yeah.
to expose gaps in government's climate policy. So, since you mentioned fossil fuels, I filed an RDI with Petroleum Ministry and several different ministries that engage with, that are dependent upon fossil fuels directly, for example, Civil Aviation Ministry, asking them what policies or what initiatives have they put in place to reduce reliance on oil, because recent data from International Energy Agency suggests that we have reached the peak of oil production, and going forward, oil supply will be in decline. It will not be able to match with the demand of oil consuming nations like India and China. So this thing is called peak, and all our economic assumptions, all our assumptions of rapidly moving towards a consumerist society are based on the fundamental assumption of continuous supply of cheap energy. Now, because of reduction in oil extraction, oil prices are going crazy over the last decade. So the rate of growth of oil price, for example, in the last decade, is like 20-25 times the rate of growth over the previous 5 decades.
Right.
Now, this fact is not understood at all. So, I mean, there's a clear indication here that we need to power down from a fossil fuel consuming economy to one that adjusts to the irrefutable fact of energy descent in which we are going.
Right.
And we are heading towards major problems, actually, if you study this issue in greater detail, because we are completely dependent upon on fossil fuel in every way.
Right.
And,
right.
Once
so,
there is, yeah.
Yeah, it's, Nagraj, can I, if I can bring you in here as we sort of run out of time, you know, way forward, I mean, you know that obviously we are already, I mean, as a country, we are generally of the opinion that we are lagging when it comes to economic growth. Obviously, so I mean, there is a focus on economic growth. Energy and power will play an important role in it. There's also an urgency to, let's say, clear a lot of power projects which are also linked to coal and so on and so forth. What are the precautions that we can take? I mean, I think most of this will happen. Power projects will come up, many of them or most of them will be coal-based. But what are the precautions that we can take to ensure that things are better managed and monitored here on?
Well, look, firstly, no, this new government, is, I'm afraid, is actually taking away some of the precautions that already existed on paper. The range of environmental measures and policy changes that they're putting in place, which actually takes away even some of the precautions, however weak or incomplete or partial or delayed, that are already in place. So one is clearly, let's not do that. Let's not go down that road. That's one. Secondly, implement very cleanly all the existing laws, whether it's PISA or whether it's other existing laws. That's one. Two, let's try to implement, use all the existing technologies of energy efficiency or FTG and so on, which produce these are various kinds of emissions. But fundamentally, I think it's not a question of precautions. I think it's a question, really crucially, of one's development trajectory, one's choices, where does one energy comes from and whom does it go to. And we're talking in the wake of another, you know, incredibly grim climate disaster in Kashmir. And this is the fourth climate disaster in 15 months. If you include Uttarakhand, the cyclone in Orissa and the eastern coast, and in Maharashtra, the surrounding areas, the hailstones that devastated agriculture and killed numerous animals, and now we have Kashmir. I mean, this is the fourth disaster. I mean, what is going to take for people to understand that this is going to happen more seriously, more frequently, with greater intensity, and is going to harm the poor? You know, so My point is that precautions are well, and there's certain things we need to take at different levels, but we need to think out of the box. We can't remain in the box and think of, you know, delta difference in terms of solutions.
Right.
We need to also do things on a different scale, yeah, which is a different political scale, and that requires a stronger movement. I mean, just to you know, talk about something that's happened elsewhere. Let's say solar in Germany, you know, has been a huge expansion of photovoltaic in Germany in the last 10 years. And a lot of it is rooftop photovoltaic, which is supplied back to the grid. Now, that is something that I think that can happen in India, though there are certain specific housing constraints and so on here. But that's possible. But that needs a movement here. These people to come up. It's not just policymakers or industrialists
right.
we need to address.
Right.
We need to sort of take care of the people at large.
So what
demand
both of
these.
You are saying is that, you know, I think that this is, it is a problem that's not going to go away, as we all know. But it's important to, while we try and fix the some of the legal and procedural issues to ensure that things are managed, but also to make sure that we really manage things on the demand side, and that in most such cases is the only medium to long-term solution. We've run out of time, gentlemen. Thank you so much for joining us on the India Hangout. We're going to, of course, continue talking about the environment and some of the challenges that we face in our lives every day. Thanks for watching.